Okay, in this video what we want to do is I kind of want to introduce the idea of electrostatic charge, some of the things that we know about it, and sort of how we characterize how it interacts. Now, when we talk about electrostatic charge, I think the best thing for us to take a moment to do is to sort of understand that in physics we treat electrostatic charge not as something by itself, it's rather a property of matter. In other words, we don't say electrons are charges, we say electrons are pieces of matter that have both the property of mass and the property of charge. That's technically the way that we look at it now. Now, when you look at classical physics, especially early on, that distinction is not made. The early papers and the authors that wrote those papers tended to think of charge as something. So a lot of times in the vocabulary we'll talk about, well, this charge here affects that charge there, as if the charges in and of themselves were individual things. That's probably not the best way to think about it. Think about little pieces of matter that possess this property we call charge. Okay? So as we talk about electrostatic charge and we talk about the properties that charge has and the things we know about charge, keep that in mind. Okay? So, the earliest good experiments done on electrostatic charge were done by Ben Franklin back in the 1750s. It's the first really good physics done where somebody's keeping track of things and being very careful in their experimentation. And it's really what gives Franklin, you know, kind of his name in a lot of ways. Now, those things are going to extend in when we talk about the properties or the things we know about charge. Those experiments extend all the way until the 1900s. And so what we're going to try to do is summarize some of that information in one sort of tidy way. But I want you to understand it didn't come about all so cleanly. Okay. So the first thing that we know about charge, number one, is Franklin was able to figure out that charge comes in two types. As Franklin does his work by rubbing various substances together to get electrostatic charge transfer to take place, he determines that charges come in two types. He has to give them names. Now, everybody from Franklin for a period of time sees the obvious parallels between magnetism and electricity. And so when they see two types, you know, you could choose north and south, but instead what we look at is we say we have positive charges and we have negative charges, okay? And so that's the first thing. And by the way, one of the easiest ways to produce charged objects where you can see different types of charges is to take two pieces of scotch tape, put them together, make sure they're electrically neutral, and then tear them apart, and you'll actually, one tape will be a positively charged tape, the other tape will be a negatively charged tape. Now, the second thing he was able to determine is you can charge objects two ways, in a sense. First way you can charge objects is by transfer. What I can do is I can take a charge that exists on one thing, and by touching that thing to something else, I can transfer some of the charge from the one thing to the other, and the other object will have that charge. Okay, so that's known as charge transfer. The other way that you can do this is sometimes what you call charge induction. And induction's a little more complicated. If you remember the experiment where you take like a sweater or your hair or something, you take a latex balloon, and you rub the balloon on the sweater, and then you walk up and you can stick the balloon to the wall, what's really going on there is the wall starts out electrically neutral, okay? What you do is when you rub the balloon on your hair or your sweater or whatnot, you're transferring charge from your hair or your sweater to the balloon. Then when the balloon comes up to the wall, usually what you have is you have some negative charge on the balloon. It pushes a little of the negative charge of the wall away, leaving exposed positive charge, and that creates the ability of the balloon to stick to the wall. So the wall becomes charged in that little region by induction. What's fundamental to understand in both of these is the fundamental idea that charge is conserved. In other words, like all conservation laws, conservation of mass, conservation of energy, conservation of momentum, when we say charge is conserved, that what we're really saying here is it cannot be created or destroyed. So if an object starts out electrically neutral, not having charge, and then you do something and it has charge, the charge had to come from somewhere. So again, back to our balloon example, if I rub a balloon on a sweater, what I'm doing is I'm transferring some of the negative charge from the sweater onto the balloon, and that leaves the sweater positively charged by the same amount the balloon is now negatively charged. In other words, I didn't create the negative charge on the balloon, I transferred it from the sweater onto the balloon. Okay, so charge is conserved. It cannot be created or destroyed. All right, so that's the second thing that we know about this. Third thing Franklin figures out, and we're going to come back to this, is that charges exert forces on other charges. And like I say, we'll come back and flesh this out quite a bit more. What you guys already probably know is the rule, like charges repel, opposite charges attract. Now we're going to break that out, but that's the most common thing. Just like in magnets, north poles repel north poles attract south poles. What we know is positively charged objects repel positive charged objects. Negatively charged objects repel negatively charged objects, but if I bring a positive and a negative charge together, they will attract each other, okay? So in doing that, what happens is this creates forces. Those are push or pulls, and maybe we want to characterize those. The next property we want to talk about wasn't discovered until a good bit later than these first three, and that is what we say is charge is quantized. Now, what that means is there is a smallest charge. There, you know, one of the things you can think of as charge is this sort of continuous thing. I could have any amount of charge I want, whatever. And what we found out is while the smallest amount of charge you can have is really tiny, there is a smallest amount of charge. And you can't have less than that, and you can't have fractional amounts. Okay, so you can't have 1.5 electrons. You either have 1 electron or 2, not in between. Now, of course, when you start getting to larger amounts of charge, what we normally say is it starts to look very continuous because you have an enormous number, and adding or subtracting one little charge isn't going to make that big a difference. But charge is quantized. Now, what is the smallest charge? When we talk in classical physics terms, which is anything up to about 1900, 1910. The idea is that the smallest amount of charge is the charge on the electron, and that's 1.6 times 10 to the minus 19, and the unit of charge is called the Coulomb. Okay, or sometimes we just use C. But that's the smallest amount of charge in the classical physics. Now when you start getting into modern physics and start talking about things that electrons are made up like quarks, a quark is 1/3 that, but then you can't get smaller than a quark. Okay? So understand, for any classical physics, first year physics class, we're going to be talking mainly about this charge on the electron. Electrons, this is the magnitude. We would say an electron has a negative charge. A proton has a positive charge, same amount. Okay? So, unit of charge is the Coulomb. Coulomb's an enormously large amount of charge, and it's very rare in nature. You would actually see one full Coulomb of charge just sitting on something, okay? But we still use this unit because it kind of goes back to how we define some things in the idea of current, which we'll talk about in a later video. All right, so these are some things that we know about electrostatic charge. I want to come back and sort of finish our video discussion here by looking at this idea. The guy who sort of really decides that this has to be looked at is the guy we named the unit after. His name was Coulomb. He's a French physicist. And Coulomb's really interesting because he looks at this and he wants to quantize this. He wants to say, okay, it's not just good enough to say they exert forces on each other. I want to sort of be able to determine how those forces act, how to quantify them. And so what he does is he uses Newton's universal law of gravitation as sort of his guiding light does various sets of experiments with currents, and is able to show, and his data is a little tenuous, but he makes this sort of leap of faith all of us, and he's absolutely right, is he's able to show that the force law between two charges looks just like the force law between two masses. So let's go ahead and write that down. And he says that the electrostatic force between two charges is equal to K. Charge 1, and we use Q usually to describe what a charge is, times charge 2 over the radius squared. And if we make this a vector, this is that unit vector. So the idea here would be if this is an object with charge Q1 on it, this is an object with charge Q2 on it, and that's the distance r between them, there will be a force given by this force law that will act along the line between the two forces. Now, the cool thing about using positive and negative here is, if I put in two positive charges here, I'll get positive and positive, and what will happen is that will give me a positive force, which we know is repulsive. It will push away along the line between the two forces. Same thing will happen because a negative times a negative is still a positive. But the great thing is if I have a positive and a negative in here, positive times a negative gives me a negative out in front, just like with the gravitational law, and that'll cause them to attract. So, if we look at this, that's how we deal with the direction of the force. Again, it's an inverse square law, so if I double the distance, the force is 1/4 the size. If I triple the distance, it's 1/9 the size. Last thing we have to talk about is this guy right here, K. K is a constant like the gravitational constant big G was. K is 8.99 times 10 to the 9 Newton meter squared per Coulomb squared. Now what I want you to understand is when we did this for the gravitational constant, this was 6.67 times 10 to the negative 11. What this means is, as we talked about before, the gravitational force is an enormously weak force compared to this, or better said, the electrostatic force is an enormously strong force compared to the gravitational force. You don't have to have a lot of charge to create some significant sized forces when we're dealing with charges, unlike with masses where we have to have a lot of it to get a big gravitational force. So, the other way you will see this written, by the way, is taking K and writing it as 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught. Now, this comes from setting this up and setting these equations up in the higher level sort of mathematics of electrodynamics. But epsilon naught is a constant of the universe called the permittivity of free space. Permittivity of free space. This is equal to 8.85 times 10 to the minus 11, Coulomb squared per Newton meter squared. So what you'll do is you will see this constant epsilon naught show up in a lot of other applications, like when we talk about the electric field of a capacitor or the speed of light or some other things, you'll see this constant show back up. So I want to show you that a K actually is this 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught that would normally sit here. But normally what we do is we just call this a constant K, make it look like G, calculate out its value from these. The thing that's very cool about this is that in Coulomb establishing this, what that means is everything that's true for gravitation, being able to define a gravitational potential energy for it, how gravity acts, all of those sorts of things, because the mathematical form's the same, we can do all the same things for the electrostatic force. That's going to help us out a long way, or a lot down the road. We'll be able to define an electrostatic potential energy, use energy bar charts, do all of that for problems involving electrostatic charges. So this kind of gives you an introduction. In the next video, what we're going to sit down and do is we're going to talk about how you use Coulomb's law to set up and solve force problems. So hang in there, keep working.